Good morning again. It's good to be here. Really glad, Brother Larry, you got here. I was thinking a lot of you and how we were going to, what we were going to do to get to see you before you left. So I'm really glad you're here. And Brother Larry encouraged me to continue on from where I was speaking last week, and I've taken his advice and counsel on that. And we're going to talk about the unity of the Spirit today. So as you can see, our topic is the unity of the Spirit. And I think this is a very important topic to understand. In Psalms 133, in verse 1, we read this text recently. Behold, how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. This is the only place in the Old Testament the word unity is used, by the way. And it's only used in two other places in the Bible, and we're going to see both those today, too. And they're in Ephesians. So if we could turn to Ephesians, we're going to be focusing on Ephesians 4, 1 through 3, and especially Ephesians 4, 3 today. Because Ephesians 4, 3 is where it uses the phrase, the unity of the Spirit. It's used nowhere else in the Bible. But we're going to see the word unity used there, and we're also going to see the word unity used a little later in chapter 4. But I'd like for you to first turn to Ephesians chapter 3. It would be really great if we could read the whole book of Ephesians through, but I'm going to have to let you do that on your own and catch up with me, because this whole book is really bringing us to the point that we're at, or at least the first three chapters are. And so just to gather some of the context, I'm going to go back and start in Ephesians 3:13. So if you could be with me in Ephesians 3:13, and we're going to read through to Ephesians 4:15. Okay? It says, wherefore I desire that ye faint not at my tribulation for you, which is your glory. For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. Chapter 4. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long-suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Remember that. Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. Verse 7. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descendeth is the same also that ascendeth up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. Verse 11. And he gave some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers, for the perfecting of the work of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Verse 13. Till we all come in the unity of the faith. Now here we find that word unity again. We saw it in verse 3, now we see it again. We saw it in Psalms 133, the only times that unity is used in the King James Bible, at least that word. Concept is elsewhere, but the word. Verse 13 again, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men, and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceit, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up unto him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. And there's much more we could look at. But we're talking about today the unity of the Spirit. Well, what does that mean? That's what we want to understand. The impediments for this study actually goes back to this last summer. I was in Romania, and there were some brethren that I had some theological differences with that wanted to meet with me, and I was, of course, encouraged to meet with them. And they came to see me, and we were talking for a while, and I was asking them about certain doctrines. And they said, "We're really not interested in doctrine so much right now. We're just trying to find the people that have the same spirit we have. And then when we find the people with the right spirit, all the doctrines will fall into place." I thought that was interesting. Recently, I heard this basically repeated, that before the unity of the faith can be accomplished, there must be a unity of the spirit. Oh, maybe we just could call it having kindred spirits. Have you ever heard the expression, you know, this is a kindred spirit of mine? That means we think alike, we have a similar mind. Of course, there's a lot of people who are kindred spirits. You know, Hitler was a kindred spirit with Himmler, right? Did that make him good? They were kindred spirits for sure, but not very good kindred spirits. And so as we think about the book of Ephesians first, just thinking about the overview of the book, Paul's writing to a church that has both Jews and Gentiles. There are people from Asia, people from Europe in it. There are slaves and there are free men. And all symbols of a disrupted world, you could say, were right there in Ephesus. And Paul's goal was to restore all these people as to be one or to have unity in Christ. And this would necessitate a unity of each person, each family, the church, and all the races that might be there. Now, in this epistle, the Apostle Paul has less to say about faith than he does grace. In his earlier writings, he has stressed the relationship of the individual to Jesus Christ and to salvation. But here he begins to stress more the group, the church, the body of Christ. In fact, he speaks here about being in Christ in this epistle 9 different times. He only speaks about things being accomplished through Christ once in this epistle. In worse word studies in the Greek New Testament, Volume 4, page 93, he makes a comment here on Ephesians. And he says, the first 3 chapters contain doctrine. Now, keep this in mind. This is going to be important to understand. And we'll see this repeated with this concept from another source, so it's not just him who understands this. The first 3 chapters contain doctrine, the last 3 exhortation. This is the proper order. For only in doctrine can one see the sweet reasonableness of the exhortations and obtain the necessary power and technique to obey them. In brief, God says in chapters 1 through 3, I've made you a saint. In chapters 4 through 6, he says, now live a saintly life. So the first 3 chapters, if you look at an outline of Ephesians, they contain basically the doctrine. And then the last 3 chapters contain the exhortations to follow the teachings. And if you, for instance, look in the Seventh-day Adventist Bible Commentary, and this is a picture of the outline of the Bible Commentary, it's on pages 595 and 596 of Volume 6 of the Commentary. You notice here that you have, after the in the outline, the first thing is, of course, the greeting, and then point number 2, the doctrinal section. You notice that's from chapter 1, verse 3 to 321. Basically the first 3 chapters. And then you come down to section number 3, and of course it subsections that, shows how it breaks down. And then you come down to section 3, the practical section, and then that's chapters 4 through 6. So this is pretty well understood by most people who read the book of Ephesians through. This is just not my idea or one or two people's comments. But what we want to do today, we're talking about the unity of the Spirit. And we want to go back to Ephesians 4, and we're going to reread the first 3 verses, and then we're going to focus, like a laser, on verse 3, word by word. We're going to go through this. So back in Ephesians 4, Paul again says, I therefore, in other words, when he says I therefore, it's because of what I've said before. And remember those first 3 chapters before this, they're dealing with the doctrine. Therefore, the prisoner of the Lord beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherein you're called. In other words, you walk, you live according to things that you've been taught. with all lowliness and meekness, with long-suffering, forbearing one another in what? In love. Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. He says, you are to endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Now, this is the text on the screen. We have the text, and we actually have the Greek text above it. And Greek is an interesting language because word order is not always essential for many parts. You can say the same thing by switching the words around, and people know exactly what you mean because it's an inflected language, it uses word endings and so on. But in this particular verse, Ephesians 4:3, the Greek text is in the exact same order that we would read it in English. So it just happens to be in the same order here. So I've just put it there so you can see it. And in fact, here I've put it into a little chart in the next slide. And so we have the Greek expression with the equivalent English underneath of it. And what we want to do, we want to look at each one of these about seven, well, let's see, one, two, three, four, five, six main parts. To this verse. And look at all these words. Make sure we understand what's being said. And that will help us. Now, the English word endeavoring, it comes from this Greek word spoudazotis, which is from spoudazo. Now, in all of these cases except one that we're going to look at, this second word, the one that's in red on your screen, is the main word we're concerned about, because that is the what we call in the grammar the lemma of the word. It's the basic functional word. Then you have variations of that word, and endeavoring here is translated from simply a variation of that word. And sometimes that's helpful to know the variation, although it really won't make any difference in all of these except one that we're going to look at today. There's one that makes a very large difference in. And this word, though, it means to be eager, to give diligence. One of the lexicons, the Lonida, the Greek-English lexicon of the New Testament based on somatic domains, says to do something with intense effort and motivation, to work hard, to do one's best, to endeavor. So he says, when he says endeavoring to do this, that means it's something that you're really intense about, something you're working hard about, something you're really focused on, something you're focused on. We also have, again, to take care, make haste, to do one's best. It speaks of a determined effort. It has the idea of exertion in it. So what we're reading here, whatever this means in Ephesians 4:3 about this concept of the unity of the Spirit, is something that we are to apply ourselves to. It's not something that we can just pass by on and be indifferent toward. Now, Paul uses this same word, spoudazo, in a couple other places. I'm just going to show you a couple places he uses it in to give you an idea of how it can be used. But keep your hand here in Ephesians, because we're basically going to be locked in here most of the time today. But go to 2 Timothy 2:15. He says, study to shew thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You're familiar with that verse, aren't you? But it's interesting that the word that we translate study here, the word that we translate study is this same Greek word that is translated endeavoring in Ephesians 4:3, spoudazo. Also in 2 Timothy, Paul used this word a couple times in this epistle, three times actually. In chapter 4, verse 9, do thy diligence to come shortly unto me. And the word diligence here is spoudazo again. And then also in chapter 4 and verse 21, do thy diligence to come before winter. And again, it's translated from this same word, diligence. Now, so if we just go back here a little ways, here we have this word for endeavoring, but the next part is to keep. We're going to keep something, but what does this word keep mean? Well, if I scroll just a little bit more, here we go. This word keep is from Tyrian, or it is Tyrian, which comes from a Greek word, tyro. And it means to keep or to guard or to watch over. To keep, to guard, to watch over, to protect. Where says that it means to keep by guarding, to guard by exercising watchful care. It speaks of guarding something which is in one's possession. And I'll just give you a couple places where you can find this same word used to give you an idea of how it fits. In Revelation chapter 12 and verse 17. Do you know what Revelation 12, 17 means or says? You probably do, but let's turn there anyhow. Revelation 12, 17. And the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus. They keep, they have, they obey, they watch, they guard over the commandments of God. And Revelation chapter 14 and verse 12. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that what? That keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. And so here again we have this concept now where we are endeavoring, we are pressing forward, we are applying ourselves, we are focused to guard, to keep, to protect something. What is it? What is it? Well, he says it's the unity of the Spirit. And this word unity is henotia, and it's from henotis, and it means oneness or unity. It is also has the concept of unanimity. Unanimity. Now, what is unanimity? If I say we have unanimity, well, what does that mean?
Togetherness.
How much togetherness?
Complete.
It means complete. It means there's not a dissenting vote. We have unanimity here, an agreement. I think of our Adventist pioneers when they were writing the preamble to the 1872 Statement of Fundamental Beliefs. And they said, we do not put forth this as having any authority with our people, nor is it designed to secure uniformity among them as a system of faith. But it is a brief statement of what is and has been with great unanimity held by them. So maybe there was one or two people who had a couple different ideas, but not many. Not many. They had great unanimity. And so God is wanting to have a people come together. They are laser focused to guard, to keep, to protect a type of unanimity among them. Now, in the Greek, and this is now where it gets interesting. This is where it's going to get interesting. And if I'm losing you, just say, hey, I need you to repeat that again. Because all I'm simply doing right now is just giving you a little more depth or insight to the words that are translated in Ephesians 4:3 right now. But now we're coming up to a situation that seems to be the most plainest one to you, that will probably seem to be the one you're familiar with if you don't have any familiarity with any of the rest of it. But it's the one that we have to look at. Of the Spirit. Of the Spirit. Now, Spirit is from the word pneuma. That's in red, pneuma. But this is pneumatos. Pneumatos. And it's a different form of this basic word, pneuma. And this form is important to know here. Because you know what? There's really just a couple letters that are different here in this word, right? I don't know if any of you remember, but on prayer meeting about a year ago, maybe more than a year ago, I showed a study where if you know, because sometimes we know that if you change one word in a verse, it can change a lot, right? And I showed you an example of where you change one letter of one word and it totally changed the meaning of the verse. Just one letter. And what we have here is something we need to understand, I believe, that will help us. Because we don't always think in the same grammatical lines that the Greek people did. We think in English lines of grammar. And this maybe is going to help you here. This word, pneumatos, and here I just have a little thing that I've taken out of a grammar section. But it shows the morphological breakdown of this word. It's number 4151 in the Strong's, if you want to look up in the Strong's. But that's basically pneuma. You look at that up, it's just pneuma. But now this is pneumatos. And you notice it says NGSN under it. Do you see that? SGNN. And this is what we would call sort of like the morphology of the word. That means it's a noun. It is genitive, singular, and neuter. And let me just go backwards a little bit. In English, almost everything is neuter. I have a Bible. It's a Bible. Is it a he or she? It's just a Bible. You have a chair. I have a phone. It's just a neuter thing. Sometimes we apply gender to a few things. Like we talk about a ship and we say she. A ship is a she, but we don't have much gender. But in Greek language, you have a lot of gender. But if you don't have something that has a specific gender, it's neuter. And pneuma is always neuter. Always neuter. And so any adjective goes with it has to be neuter. Like Holy Spirit, it's not masculine, it's neuter. Hagios pneuma. And the hagios, or hagia, depending on the variation of what's being used, is always neuter too. This is singular because it's not spirits, it's one spirit. But the part that we want to really look at is this G, the G part, genitive. Now, I don't know if that means anything to you, but I'll tell you what it means. It means that it is possessive. It means it is possessive. Now, in our chart earlier, ton pneumatus, but that word ton in the front that looks like a T-O-V there, That's simply the definite article. That's the. But notice we have of the Spirit, the unity of the Spirit. But there's no word in the Greek that makes the word of here, right? There's no word for of. You see that, right? Because in the Greek language, because it is an inflected language, a language that uses these special endings and prefixes, you don't need it. They understand that you have of with it. For instance, in Acts chapter 12 and verse 24, it says, but the word of God grew and multiplied. Do you see that? The word of God grew and multiplied. Now that's the way that we say it sometimes in English because we're used to reading the Bible. We might speak about the law of God. But in English, we use something else to show possession. We use a little squiggly mark called an apostrophe. I would usually say, if I was saying this in English, I would say God's word grew, wouldn't I? God's word grew. That's how I would show possession. And in this verse, verse 24, God, the word for theos here, is in the genitive form. We go back to Ephesians 3:19. Here it says, and to know the love of Christ. The love of Christ. But that could equally, just as accurately, and maybe more understandably, be translated and to know Christ's love. Because it's possessive. Christ possesses the love. And so in our verse that we're considering, when it says to keep the unity of the Spirit, it could also be translated very accurately to keep the Spirit's unity. You see, the unity belongs to the Spirit. I don't know about you, but when I think about it that way, because that's the way we think in English more so, it just puts a little different, maybe a lot different emphasis on it. And the way I have to consider that verse, or should consider the verse, then maybe I'm used to considering it. He speaks about in the bond, sundesmo, from the word sundesmus. And it just simply means that which ties together. It's like a ligament. That which pulls together. Colossians 3:14. He says, and above all these things put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. In other words, love is what ties perfection and everything together. And then considering still one more word in Ephesians 4:3, the word peace, irenus, from irene. And this particular word is used 91 times in the New Testament. 89 times it's translated peace. One time it's translated quietness. One time it's translated rest. In Acts 9:31 it says, then the churches had rest. Then the churches had peace. Acts 24 verse 2, Tertullus was before Felix. He says that by thee we enjoy great quietness. Because of you we have peace in our land. But this word simply means peace. It's just consistently translated peace or something that is a synonym of peace throughout the New Testament. So this Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 3 could be understood in this sense. Doing your best, earnestly, diligently doing your best to safeguard the Spirit's unity in the bond of peace or in peace's bond, because actually peace is genitive also in this. It's possessive. You see, peace owns something. Peace owns that bond. And that's what it's saying. So we could say either the unity of the Spirit or the Spirit's unity. They say the same thing, but again, they may enable us to see a little clearer the actual structure of the verse, because we don't usually use the same structure the Greeks use. We use a different structure. And it just helps me to understand this is speaking about something that belongs to the Spirit. It's the Spirit's unity. It's just not a thing. It's something that belongs to the Spirit. Now let's think about the work of the Spirit for a little bit. Because if we're talking about the Spirit's unity, we need to understand how that unity is going to come about, or what is involved in that. In 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 21. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 21. He says, "For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost." The text says Holy Ghost if you have King James, but it just as easily could have been translated Holy Spirit, because the word that they translate ghost here is translated in so many other places just Spirit. It's pneuma, okay? The Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit guided and directed in the writing of the Bible. Is that right?
Yes.
Yes. Now we know that 2 Corinthians 3:17 says the Lord is that Spirit, right? Mm-hmm. And if you turn back to 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 11, 1 Peter 1:11, it says, "Searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ which was in them did signify when it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow." That's 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 11. So it's saying, Peter says in these two different epistles that it was the Holy Spirit or the Spirit of Christ that inspired the apostles. So what we have in the writing of the Bible is the work of the Spirit, right? 2 Timothy 3:16. It says, "All Scripture is given by inspiration of God." All Scripture is given by inspiration of God. But you probably know that when it says inspiration of God, there's one Greek word for all that, and it means God breathed. God breathed. Now, what does pneuma mean in its most basic fundamental form? It's air, or wind, a blast, or a breath. It's the breath. God breathed. The Spirit of God. All Scripture is given by the Spirit of God, God breathing His Spirit upon the prophets. The Spirit, then, will never lead or bring unity, friends, contrary to the Word of God. In John chapter 16, in verse 13, "Howbeit when He, the Spirit of," the Spirit of unity. Well, there is a Spirit of unity, isn't it? It's the Spirit's unity. But here it says, "When He, the Spirit of truth, is come, He will guide you into all truth." Well, if He's the Spirit of truth, He must guide into truth. He can't guide into error, or He wouldn't be the Spirit of truth. "For He shall not speak of Himself, but whatsoever He shall hear, that shall He speak, and He will show you things to come." And remember, of course, Jesus said over and over, "I don't speak of Myself, I speak the words which the Father gave Me." In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, Paul asks a question. We should look at that question. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 13. And Paul's making a specific application. My application may be just a little different, but not in principle. Not in principle. 1 Corinthians 1:13, he asks the simple question, "Is Christ what?
Divided.
Now, if we are the body, think about this, if we are to be the body of Christ, if we are the true body of Christ, is the true body of Christ divided? No. So if there's division, then there's a problem here. Something's not, someone's not, really, of the body of Christ then. J.H. Wagoner was an early Adventist pioneer who knew Ellen White and worked with Ellen White a lot and other early men. And he wrote a book called a Refutation of the Doctrine Called the Age to Come. And in that book, on page 8, he said this. I've got two paragraphs here. "We may not entertain any faith contrary to God's revelation. Though man has no right to control our faith, God has. Let me just pause here. Do you get what he's saying? In other words, I can't control your faith. I have no right to tell you what to believe, but God does. But God does. The question is, where does God do it? Does he do it through some impression I get? Does he do it because I think I had some glossolalia experience, I'm speaking in tongues and teaching something new and infallible and great, and maybe it's contradictory to the Word of God, but it just came from the Spirit, it must be great. I had this warm feeling inside, you know, as the Mormons say, I have the burning of the bosom, it must be right. It says, we may not entertain any faith contrary to God's revelation. Though man has no right to control our faith, God has, for he that believeth not God hath made him a liar, 1 John 5:10, for which offense he will be held to an account. If this were not so, and if God had given to all the right and privilege to think and believe what they pleased, he would be unjust in punishing unbelief, as it were only be the exercise of a given right. Now, let me just pause and make sure we get this clear. Wagner's not saying you can't believe anything you want. I mean, you can in the sense that God will allow you. He doesn't force you to believe any particular thing. But friends, if you want to be saved, you do have to believe a particular thing. Because he's going to hold you accountable for what you don't believe and what you don't follow. He goes on to say, and he will punish unbelief. He has a right to guide our faith, and as his word is truth and does not teach yea and nay, he has a right to require that we should all be one speak, the same thing, be of one mind, come to the unity of the faith, keep the unity of the Spirit. And so Wagner's understanding of this unity of the Spirit was the unity of the faith. We're all speaking the same thing. We're all having the same faith. Because, friends, if it is the Spirit's unity and the Spirit leads and guides and directs by the Word of God, then the unity has to be determined by the Word of God alone. That's right. And not by what I think or what he thinks. Amen. The Spirit of truth, friends, comes from the God of truth. Amen. Ellen White also noted that God's Spirit will never lead one in a course that is contrary to his word or that leads to separation from that people who are giving the last message of mercy. Review and Herald, June 6, 1887, paragraph 3. Isn't that something? Not only does the Holy Spirit not lead contrary to the word, but not it will not lead us away from the true people of God. Now, I know some of us have had to make breaks and divisions. But friends, the point and the purpose of that is to come into where the people of God are, not to lead the people of God. Because we are to be of one mind. We are to be one people. In 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 11, he says, finally, brethren, farewell. Be perfect. Be of good comfort. Be of, what's the text say?
One mind.
Live in peace, and the God of love and peace shall be with you. Friends, if you are of one mind, you can live in peace and love. But when you have vastly different ideas, it can be very hard to dwell together in unity, right? It's impossible because it's not biblical unity. Now, there's a type of unity, don't get me wrong, there's a type of unity that the world teaches, that the ecumenical movement teaches, and anyone who's in favor of those principles of ecumenicalism that says it's okay for everybody to get together and we'll just pray and study and we'll have a great time together and who knows what might happen. 1 Peter 3:8. Again, notice the emphasis here on one mind. He says, finally, be ye all of one mind, having compassion one of another, love as brethren, be pitiful, be courteous. And I'm going to make note of this later, but I'm going to go ahead and make note of it now. When we think of doctrines, sometimes, for instance, we tend to think about the real hard, you know, deep issues. The issues that we write fundamental beliefs about. Issues about the seventh-day Sabbath, the millennium, the investigative judgment, the second coming of Christ. But I want to ask you a question. Is biblical love a doctrine? Is being pitiful and courteous, showing humility, is that a biblical doctrine? I mean, remember, a doctrine just means teaching. Doesn't the Bible teach about those things? Yeah. Sure, absolutely. Now, they may not be listed in the fundamentals because to many people, they are so fundamental, they are so plain, they are so obvious that we don't include them because we just figure everybody must believe those things. But they're part of our doctrine too. Don't mistake that in any way. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. I won't turn there because you know what it says. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. So if we're all to have the same mind, it should be the mind of Christ. The mind of Christ. We're to think like Christ did. We're to know and believe the truths that Christ taught. We are to have that love that came from the mind of Christ. We have that pitifulness that came from the mind of Christ. We are to have that humility that came from the life of Jesus. Now, in manuscript releases, volume 8, page 68.4, it says, we are often exhorted, be ye all of one mind, which means, now notice this, which means the same as endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bonds of peace. Wait a minute. Where did Ellen White get that thing in quotes there? Where did it come from? You tell me.
Ephesians
chapter 4 and verse 3. And she says that to be of one mind is the exact same thing as endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit or the Spirit's unity in the bond of peace. That's one mind. She says, all should seek to draw as closely together as possible by dwelling upon those things which we can all agree rather than upon those things which seem to create a difference. Kindred spirits are people who think alike. And that's fine if they have the mind and the thoughts of Christ. That's really what we want. We want kindred spirits who have those kind of things. Now, we quoted something from J.H. Wagoner a little bit ago. He had a son, E.J. Wagoner, also became a preacher. He was actually a medical doctor who became a preacher. But he made this statement, and this was found in the Present Truth. He was in England working, publishing what we call the Present Truth edition in England, the UK edition, in January 30, 1902. And he said this, and it's so evident of self-truth. Just listen to how clearly he makes it, though. It was the Holy Spirit that united the multitude of them that believed into one heart and soul. For we read that the unity of the Spirit is to be kept in the bond of peace. It is only by possessing one common spirit that a multitude of people can be of one heart and one soul, and the Holy Spirit of God is the only universal, all-pervading spirit. Now, I could go to a church, and I'll just give an example. I could go to a Baptist church, and I have a specific one in my mind. I won't say what it is, but I know if I go to that church, people are going to love me. They're going to be kind to me. They're going to show me graciousness. They're going to be sweet to me. And I appreciate that. But are we really kindred spirits? Because they believe in a different spirit than I do, friends. They really believe in a different spirit. And in fact, they believe in a different Jesus. They believe in a Jesus who is the second person of the Trinity, who's really not the Son of God. And so, you know, we can be buddies, friends, but that doesn't make you a true kindred spirit, biblically. I hope we get that. From Signs of the Times, this is an Ellen White statement, February 7, 1900. He in whose heart Christ abides recognizes Christ abiding in the heart of his brother. Christ never wars against Christ. Remember we read in 1 Corinthians that Christ is never divided? Christ never wars against Christ. Christ never exerts an influence against Christ. Christians are to do their work, whatever it may be, in the unity of the Spirit for the perfecting of the whole body. But again, friends, who is Christ? Who is the Christ? It's like if we were going to have a communion service here today, and we might say, well, you know, anyone who accepts Christ should be able to come in and keep communion. But who is Jesus Christ? Who is Christ to that person? You know, some people think that Muhammad is a Christ. He's a type of Christ. You know, or that the Buddha is a type of Christ. Or whatever. I mean, it's got to be the right Christ. It can't be the wrong Christ. That would violate all the principles, wouldn't it? Now, going back and remembering the context of these verses in Ephesians, remember we noted that the first three chapters contain the doctrine and the last three are the exhortation. And in chapter 3, we read some verses there that we are to be rooted and grounded in what? In love. We are to have a deep understanding of God's love, the length and breadth and height, and to know it with all the fullness of God, he says in Ephesians 3:19. This is what we need. There's a little reading in the book, God's Amazing Grace, devotional book by Ellen White, on page 211. This devotional, God's Amazing Grace, about four paragraphs I want to read to you. And just go with the flow with me, and I think you'll see how nice it says. I beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherein you are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long-suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. And here she's quoting from parts of Ephesians 4:1-3. She truncates just a little bit at the beginning there. Then she says, Paul urges the Ephesians to preserve unity and love. Divisions in the church dishonor the religion of Christ before the world and give occasion to the enemies of truth to justify their course. A union of believers with Christ will, as a natural result, lead to a union with one another, which bond of union is the most enduring upon earth. We are one in Christ, as Christ is one with the Father. It is only by personal union with Christ, by communion with Him, daily, hourly, that we can bear the fruits of the Holy Spirit. Our growth in grace, our joy, our usefulness, all depend on our union with Christ and the degree of faith we exercise in Him. Let me just pause before I go on. Going back to the first part of this, a union of believers with Christ will, as a natural result, lead to a union with one another. And I didn't take time to put in the statement, but there are several statements from Ellen White also. It says, you know, why are we so divided? It's because we're apart from Christ. You see, you know, Christ is that center hub, and if we come closer to Him, we're going to come closer to each other. But friends, we're not coming closer just because we happen to be in proximity. You know, I can stand right beside the Pope in proximity, and it doesn't mean that we're in unity. God forbid. But it's because we have the same mind, we have the same thoughts, we have the same purpose. We are working together in the same mind of Him. Ellen White says, the Word and Spirit of Truth dwelling in our hearts will separate us from the world. The immutable principles of truth and love will bind heart to heart, and the strength of the union will be according to the measure of grace and truth enjoyed. Now, did you get that last part? She says that this bond that we have, the strength of this union, is going to be according to the measure of grace and truth enjoined. So the more grace and truth we have, the sweeter that bond's going to be. But of course, you know, the less truth, the less grace, the bond's going to be very frail, very frail. Now in chapter 4, as we come into chapter 4, immediately after speaking about the unity of the Spirit, that we've looked at there in verse 3. We have verses 4 through 6. So let's turn back, if we're not there, and I'm not, I have to turn back. Let's turn back to Ephesians chapter 4 again. And now let's notice verses 4 through 6. He's just spoken about endeavoring to keep the Spirit's unity and the bond of peace. And now he says, there is one body and one Spirit. Even as you're called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. And I think there are seven ones there. Is that right? Seven ones. God is saying that we are to be one. But how is this one? If we have this unity of the Spirit, this Spirit's unity, what does it mean? It means, he says, that you have one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, one hope, all the way through. That it's pretty clear. And these gifts, he says in verses 7 through 15, were given for the equipping of the workers so that they could share this message. They were given, as it says in verse 13, for the unity of the faith. And it's the same word that's translated unity in verse 3. So that we could become a perfect man. And furthermore, they were given so that it says in verse 14 that we'd be not tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine. Friends, that tells me that if we have the unity of the Spirit, that we don't accept winds of doctrine. And we don't appreciate and we don't condone winds of doctrine. The text, these texts that we're looking at here, these verses in chapter 3, the verses after chapter 4, verse 3, these verses that surround the context of this statement of the unity of the Spirit, of the Spirit's unity, it's all about sound doctrine and teaching and applying that teaching. Now, there are fundamentals that we all agree are doctrines. But as I mentioned earlier, we need to understand that kindness is a Christian doctrine. Love is a Christian doctrine. Gentleness is a Christian doctrine. Humility is a Christian doctrine. Faith and grace are Christian doctrines. In 1888, there was a general conference session that the church came together as a whole in Minneapolis, Minnesota. And there was a lot of discussion at that conference that didn't go so well. And there was a lot of dissension and disunity at that conference. And Ellen White commented about that. This is in Manuscript Release, Volume 11, 229, but you can find this reference, this quote, in several different places. She says, "I was confirmed in all that I had stated in Minneapolis, that a reformation must go through the churches. Reforms must be made, for spiritual weakness and blindness were upon the people who had been blessed with great light and precious opportunities and privileges. As reformers, they had come out of the denominational churches, but they now act a part similar to that which the churches acted." Now notice she says they now act.
Yeah.
They now act. In other words, it's not necessarily what they were saying they believed that was as important as the way they were acting, the way they were treating one another with these Christian doctrines that we call love, grace, humility, gentleness, pitifulness, courteousness. As reformers, they had come out of the denominational churches, but they now act a part similar to that which the churches acted. We hoped that there would not be the necessity for another coming out. That statement bothers a lot of people in the church because they think that there was never a possibility we might have to have another coming out, but she says we'd hope there wouldn't have to be another coming out. But she says, "While we will endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bonds of peace, we will not with pen or voice cease to protest against bigotry." So she says, I'm not going to be silent about what happened to Elder Jones and Wagner. That was what it was all directed at basically, those two men. In the 1888 materials, on page 1048. This is from the 1888 materials, page 1048, paragraph 2. "Jesus did not pray for that which was not attainable by us. And if this unity is possible, why do not those who are professed followers of Christ strive more earnestly for this condition of grace? When we are one with Christ, we shall be one with his followers. The great one of the soul is Jesus, the hope of glory. Through the Holy Spirit, this unity may be attained, and love for the brethren will abound, and men will take knowledge of us, that we have been with Jesus and learned of him." And then she says, "Our life will be a reflection of his holy character. As believers in him, we shall represent his meekness of spirit, his gentleness of demeanor. Individually, the Church of God must answer the prayer of Christ till we all come into the unity of the Spirit." And so, again, this unity of the Spirit, the Spirit's unity, is what the Spirit is teaching. It's the doctrines of the Bible. But friends, it's not limited to just those big fundamentals. It's limited to every aspect of our life. How we live, how we treat other people. Do we show love, kindness, respect? Do we go visit our neighbor when we know they're sick and know that they need a visit? You know, are we obeying the unity of the Spirit in doing those things? Now, the Bible speaks about the fruit of the Spirit that results from what we believe and live. And friends, think about this. You know, our doctrines, whatever those doctrines are, those big ones, those small ones, everything in between, whatever they are, if they don't change us and make us better people, if they don't have an impact upon our life in some way, then either those doctrines are wrong or we're just not living the doctrines. I mean, there are people who can live, or they can teach and know the right doctrines, but they don't live them. They don't allow those doctrines to have a part of them. You know, Jesus said we'd be sanctified by the truth of his word. But if we don't live that truth, we can know it. The devil knows the Bible. Kevin, I think the devil can quote the Bible frontwards and backwards. But it doesn't mean that he's living by it, right? Remember what James says in James 2:19. He says, thou believest there is one God, thou doest well. The devils also
believe.
But that word believe means to have faith. It's the same thing as to have faith in the Greek. He has faith, but it's not living faith. Ellen White's very specific. The devil believes, but he doesn't have saving faith. So trying to find the right spirit then, to get the right doctrines, is really not the biblical plan. It's actually in reverse of the biblical plan. And if we were to adopt a plan like this, if we were going to adopt a plan where we're going to try to find people with the right spirit and then we'll get the doctrine straight, where do we stop? Think about it. Where would we stop? You know, maybe we should go to the General Conference and get all those people involved too, because we want them to have the right spirit. Maybe they've got a good spirit, the right spirit. We think. We just know their doctrines are wrong. But then maybe we take it beyond that. Let's go to the Baptist Church too, and let's get all them involved in the program. By the way, I'm all for witnessing to everybody I'm talking about, but I'm not talking about witnessing and fellowshipping and making a big hadoo together as the same thing. But if we go to the Baptists, we may as well go to the Catholics. And if we go to the Catholics, we may as well go right to the Vatican and talk to the Pope and get him involved in it, and we'll have him praying. And boy, watch out when that happens. Watch out when that happens. Now, I have some extra statements. I know our time is pressed, but I have some extra statements I'd like to share with you. And I just simply have entitled this section, Extra Spirit of Prophecy Gems. These are just some extra things I want to put in because I thought you would want me to. And I know that we are past our quote time, but we're not going to worry about that, right? Good. In selected messages, and by the way, I'm only going to share just a little bit with these. I have a few pages, but I actually have a file of over 20 pages of these gems, and I had to call them down to try to make this a little briefer. Christ calls for unity. He sure does. But he does not call for us to unify on wrong practices. The God of heaven draws a sharp contrast between pure, elevating, ennobling truth and false, misleading doctrines. He calls sin and impenitence by the right name. He does not gloss over wrongdoing with a coat of untempered mortar. I urge our brethren to unify upon a true scriptural basis. Amen. Unity is great. Remember Psalms 133, verse 1, we read it at the beginning? It's a wonderful thing. But friends, it has to be on a scriptural basis. It has to be upon the basis of truth. Mm-hmm. In the book Great Controversy, I think you've heard that book, page 379. If God's professed people would receive the light as it shines upon them from His Word, they would reach that unity for which Christ prayed, and that which the Apostle describes, the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. You ever hear about that? There is, he says, one body and one Spirit, even as you are called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and it references Ephesians 4, 3 through 5. But notice again the first part. If God's professed people would receive the light as it shines from what? From His Word. Then we come into this unity. So what do we have to have for this unity to occur? We have to have the light of God's Word, friends. It doesn't come from anything else.
Amen.
So notice again, the progress or the pathway is to receive the light and then to reach the unity. Not to come together in unity and then try to find the light. Ellen White was writing in Australia, and she said, 3 years ago I spoke to the company at Williamstown. There was in attendance a lady full of worldly pride who had not attended the meetings before. She consented to come this time to please her mother, who was a most worthy Christian and who had embraced the truth. I had a solemn and searching testimony to bear in reference to the infallibility of the law of God, which was established as firmly as His throne. Also in reference to the coming of the Son of God the second time, to be admired in all them that believe and love His appearing. This worldly woman was convinced. The truth took so firm a hold upon her, and she felt such conviction that she could scarcely stand upon her feet. She said that she thought her limbs would not sustain her body long enough for her to get to her home. She did not say to the Spirit of God, go thy way for this time, and when I have a more convenient season, I will call thee. She didn't do that. She came out fully and decidedly. Now the mother in her widowhood has her daughter to help her. Both are in the faith, keeping the unity of the Spirit in the bonds of peace. What happened to bring about this unity in the bonds of the peace that they had together? It was the fact that the daughter accepted the message and came under it. And that's what brought them together. In Selected Messages, Book 3. Oh, by the way, the reference to that last one we just gave is a letter. Letter 113, 1896. Now, in Selected Messages, Book 3, page 412. It says, we have a testing message to give, and I am instructed to say to our people, unify, unify. No problem. But we are not to unify with those who are departing from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. With our hearts sweet and kind and true, we are to go forth to proclaim the message, giving no heed to those who lead away from the truth. She says, well, yes, we are to unify, but we're not to unify, friends, with those who depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. And I want to tell you, friends, that when people are openly rejecting the spirit of prophecy, when people are openly denying that we're living in the antitypical day of atonement, when people are making all of these kind of teachings and accusations, friends, those are not the kind of people we can unify with.
Amen.
I'm sorry. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, and I just wanted to insert a text here in these gems. 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 14 through 18. Get equally yoked with everybody who believes damnable heresies. Does the text say that? It says, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Well, but this person believes, he believes in Jesus. He believes Jesus is the second person of the Trinity. Or he believes Jesus took the unfallen nature of Adam before he sinned. I mean, is that the same Jesus we know? For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, get together and have a big prayer meeting together.
No.
It doesn't say that?
Come out from among them.
Ah, wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye what?
Separate.
Be ye joined at the hip. Be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and I will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. There's a great promise we can claim, but friends, we can't claim that promise unless we meet the conditions. It's great to claim promises. I hear people talking about that a lot, and it's a good thing. But we better meet every condition if we're going to do that. In Testimonies for the Church, Volume 9. Tammy, you were reading from Volume 9 this morning in your devotional, is that right?
So, yeah.
I think so. If you go to page 197 on paragraph 3, you'll see just what I have up here. It says, we must now, by diligent, self-sacrificing effort, endeavor to walk in the love of Christ, in the unity of the Spirit, through sanctification of the truth. No halfway work will suffice to fulfill the representation given in the prayer of Christ. We are to practice the principles of heaven here below. In heaven, there is one grand meeting place. Well, there's people like to say we should have one meeting place too. But friends, in heaven, there's no disharmony. They believe all the same truth. Now, maybe I should just read a couple more statements because we need to make sure that we have a balance here, that we don't end up into an extreme or some kind of fanatical idea. This is from a manuscript 105 of 1900. Manuscript 105 of 1900. It's not a published manuscript prior to this last release. It says, let all be under the control of the Holy Spirit, under the direction of this Spirit. One may use the same words that others have used under similar guidance. He should not make an effort to do this or not to do it. He should leave his mind to be acted upon by the Holy Spirit. There's one thing all should do. They should endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. And when she's speaking about one may use some words and maybe you can use these words or someone else not, she's not speaking about the teachings specifically, you know, what you're teaching. She's speaking about the way you teach it. For instance, I can get a book by Uriah Smith called Daniel and Revelation. And I can read there what he's written about that. But I can also buy two books, one called The Prophet Daniel and the other The Seer of Patmos by Stephen Haskell. I can read what Haskell wrote, right? And they're teaching virtually the same thing, right down the line. But they're using different words, different expressions. They're saying it in different ways. You know, I might be preaching to you about the unity of the faith today. I could be preaching to you about the Spirit's unity today. And someone else can give a sermon on the same text and teach the same thing I'm saying, but they'll say it in a different way. Or they might even use the very words I'm using. Sometimes, back in around the eighth time of 1888, when Jones and Wagoner were preaching, people would go hear A.T. Jones preach, and they had just heard Wagoner, like the week before. And they were just shocked. They said, I heard almost the exact same words from E.J. Wagoner last week. And A.T. Jones would say, well, I haven't seen Wagoner for 3 months, you know, or something like that. In other words, the Spirit was guiding and directing. This is interesting. Churches are to be built in many places, but they need not all be built in precisely the same style. Different styles of buildings may be appropriate to different locations. So, you know, the unity of the Spirit doesn't mean that we all have to have the same, you know, cookie-cutter box church built exactly the same way. That's not what we're talking about again. And then she makes this nice statement. In the breastplate of the high priest, there were many stones, but each stone had its special light, adding to the beauty of the whole. Each stone had its special significance, bearing its important message from God. There were many stones, but one breastplate. So there are many minds, but one mind, capital M mind. In the church, there are many members, each having his peculiar characteristics, but they form one family. You know, I may have an emphasis on prophecy, someone else has an emphasis on health reform. You know, we all believe those same things, but one person may be preaching from a perspective that the other person isn't preaching from. But together, just like all those gemstones together in the breastplate, it makes one beautiful piece. And then this will be my final statement. She says, I have been greatly distressed. It has nearly taken my life to see how little effort is made to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. What is the matter? It is because this one and that one and the other one all want their own way. Perhaps they always had their own way when they were children and they've never learned to yield. Have you ever met anyone like that?
Yes.
Yeah. So here she's speaking about a type of disunity. It's not over doctrine at all. It's not over doctrine at all. It's just over the way you're going to run the church, the way things are going to happen. You have this one who wants things this way, this person wants it that way, and they can't get together. But you know, part of the doctrine of the Bible is that we are to have grace toward one another. We are to have courteousness toward one another. We are to have, you know, compassion in putting others ahead of ourselves. That's part of our doctrine, you see. And so this is a disunity. It may not be over the main doctrines, but it, in a sense it is over doctrine, but it's over the way we live. But if we can get closer to Christ, friends, if we can have His mind and His Spirit, the Spirit of Christ, then we will be in the Spirit's unity, and we'll have that. But the Bible is very explicit that we come to the teachings first, and the teachings then bring the unity. If we try to come to unity in the effect of bringing the doctrines out. Now, I know there are people who feel like that maybe that's the wrong way because it's been tried and it hasn't worked. Have you ever talked to people about the Sabbath and they didn't accept it? And then maybe you talked to someone else about the Sabbath and they didn't accept it. And then maybe you gave a study to someone and they didn't accept it. Well, maybe I should just be quiet about the Sabbath because it doesn't seem to work. People don't accept it. You know, someone said one time, and a little truth to it, that one of the definitions of insanity is doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different result. Right? So if we've tried this other before, why should we try it again? Well, friends, if we've given a Bible study to 500 people and none of them accept the Sabbath, does that mean I should quit talking about the Sabbath to someone else? It just means they're not the ones who are going to accept it. They're not the ones who are going to be part of God's people if they continue to stay in ignorance and rebellion willfully. But there's someone, friends, who's looking wistfully to heaven, and I want to be with those people, don't you?
Amen.
I want to be with those people who are going to go forward. And if people aren't going to go forward with us, they're not us. They're not part of us. It's just a fact. That's the Bible, friends. And so we can say, well, you know, we're in disunity, but we're not in any more disunity than we are in disunity with the Baptists, Methodists, Catholics, Pentecostals, and Jehovah's Witnesses. Sure, I'm in disunity with all those people because they don't believe the Bible. They have their own teachings. But that doesn't mean that we're all part of the same group. You know, remember, we spoke last week on this ecumenical movement, and remember that the one common denominator is what they believe on God. If they just can believe the same thing on God, then they all can get together and nothing else is so greatly important. Friends, that one common denominator is not enough. Not unless you fully understand it and expand it out into everything there is. And that's usually not done. So my appeal to us today is that we unify upon a true scriptural basis. That we follow what the Bible says about this and remember that the Spirit's unity is always a unity in truth and never in unrighteousness. It's never going to bring people together who have vastly different theological ideologies. It's not going to happen. Not unless they're willing to give up those ideologies that are false. And the Bible tells us, as we read, that we're not to be unequally yoked with those kinds of unbelievers. It's a disaster to do that. And we only take the chance of crippling the church by doing that. By diluting the church, by having false come in, and that affects the sheep who are there who've been trying to be faithful. And we actually put them in jeopardy, in harm's way. That's right. So may God bless us, friends, to follow truth and to love truth and to live the truth and to do what's right and to love everybody. I mean, I want to see Pope Francis saved. Okay? I want to see everybody saved. I don't have a problem with anyone. There's no one in this world that I want to be lost. I want all these people to be saved. But I realize, friends, you can't be saved outside of the truth. It's just not going to happen.